Thank you very much. And thank you for the invitation to come down and talk to you folks. Some of you probably know a little bit more about this than I do, but that's what happens when you can't keep a job at a big company. They keep moving you around. But I'm happy to talk to you about a subject that's very, very timely, particularly on college campuses, as well as the business community and a lot of the governmental organizations across the world and the non-governmental organizations as well. And that's the business of sustainable development. And I'm going to take a little different tact at this. I'll tell you right off the bat that I don't wake up every morning and think about how I'm going to save the world. I'm not a tree hugger. I'm not an environmentalist. I'm an industrialist. But I recognize that there's a role that business has to play in pressing needs that that face our planet, face our customers and our markets. And I want to talk to you a little bit about the business perspective of sustainable development and how we at Caterpillar are approaching the subject. Now, one of the questions you might have is, why now? Why do you see all the ads on television and the Super Bowl a couple of years ago, people spending, companies spending hundreds of millions of dollars to talk about how green they are and to talk about their advantage vis-a-vis the competition in the marketplace for having green or sustainable issues? And one of the facts that grabs the attention of folks an awful lot is that just in my lifetime, the population of the world has doubled. Okay, so there's twice as many people competing for the same natural resources that we had back in the 1960s. And the statistics tell out that that's going to triple. The population will actually triple to 9 billion by the year 2050. So within our lifetime, we're going to see this huge population growth as well. And the one thing that is really clear is that if we continue to develop for the next 100 years in the same manner that we developed in the past 100 years, keep in mind the Industrial Revolution and all the explosive growth post-World War II in Western Europe and the United States, if that growth were to continue for the next 100 years, we would need the equivalent of about 5.5 Earth's natural resources to sustain the growth. So clearly we have to do something different because we only have one Earth. A lot of that means using materials more efficiently, renewing our materials and our resources in the manners that we manufacture and we harvest. But a couple of startling facts here. Over 1 billion people on Earth live on less than a dollar a day. And I see a couple of bottles of water in here. They cost you about a buck. So we've got over 1 billion people in the world that are living on less than what we spend 3 or 4 times a day on a bottled water or a soft drink out of a vending machine. More than 1 billion people lack clean water, and 2 billion lack sanitation. Now let's put this in perspective. In Illinois, we flush our toilets with clean water. When was the last time we thought about water scarcity unless you were doing a project for your school or doing research on it? And yet we use clean water to flush our toilets. Now, is there something else we can do that might help ensure that people that don't have access to water do and we don't waste as much as we waste? I told you global population is growing. Two-thirds of the world's ecosystems are being degraded or used unsustainably, and that simply means that if we continue the process that we have today, they won't be around for future generations to use for themselves. So something's got to be done along those natures. And then energy consumption is expected to increase by 70% just in the next couple of decades. So we've got a real challenge out there. The energy curve is going to shoot up like this as the developing nations come to develop status, and yet the scientists tell us that we need to see emissions go like this, the opposite end of that curve, if we're going to live without a massive sustained change to our climate and the energy and the environment that we live in. So what we're looking for is how do we bridge that delta? How do you see energy growth continue to increase? Because everybody needs energy. The biggest difference between a developed nation and a developing nation is who has access to electricity. If you have access to electricity, you can heat your home, you can get your goods to market, you can improve the quality of life and the life expectation of your family and your community. And so nobody wants to put a halt to developing nations reaching developed status. But what we have to take into consideration is how we provide that energy in a manner that's sustainable for both our markets and our planet. And that's kind of a tough question to answer. Now, you've all seen the ads of the dancing elephants from GE, the compact fluorescent light bulb, the Marine Stewardship Council and their trending or their trademarking of marine engines that are more sustainable, not dumping a lot of pollutants into the ocean, the hybrid vehicles, clean diesel vehicles, Caterpillar's own sustainability report. Does business have a role in this? We would submit absolutely we do. A business like Caterpillar has never shied away from the tough challenges that society has presented, and we figure nobody knows our customers, nobody knows our business, nobody knows our markets better than we do. So if there's going to be public policy that regulates those or that attempts to regulate those, then we have a very broad interest to both our shareholders, our communities, and our company to make sure that that our beliefs are understood and that we learn and adapt with what others have to say about those issues. So when it comes to sustainability and profitability, because again, we're a business here, we have a responsibility to shareholders, we see this as challenges that represent unmet market needs. Who can provide a more sustainable product to a customer that wants to increase his wealth, whether that's mining iron ore or mining gold, mining coal, providing electricity on site to a university like this to further education of our population. New products, technologies, and business models are needed. Clearly, the way we've done business in the past won't sustain us in the future. So we need bright minds thinking of new different ways to get us from point A to point B. Business has a huge role to provide because we provide the jobs. We help create the wealth and the opportunities for people to make a better standard of living and to innovate, use the technology that's brought out from the classroom and from the entrepreneurship of individuals to bring that to market. Better, faster, smarter ways of doing things. And shareholders at the same time are demanding performance. They still want to know how many pennies per share this is going to add or detract from the bottom line. And it comes up on every quarterly conference call. So Caterpillar has four main intersections with sustainable development. Just about every facet of our business talks or intersects sustainable development in one of these four areas. The first one is energy. Whether that's bringing fuels to market cleanly and efficiently through our clean diesel products, or generating clean power from alternative fuels. We're the world's largest manufacturer of diesel and natural gas engines. So we're a petroleum-based company, right? We have millions of machines and engines out there working every day across the planet, and every one of those runs on diesel fuel, biodiesel fuel, natural gas, or liquid natural gas. So how do you create electricity cleaner on a distributed generation standpoint or a standby or a primary power situation cleaner today than we did 10 years ago or 20 years ago? And we've got some technologies that I'll talk about that actually do that. The other intersection is materials. If you think about it, everything that we have in this room today, whether you're writing with something, whether you're eating a sandwich, sitting at a table on a chair, if it wasn't grown off a plant, it was mined. Came from natural resources. Somebody added value to it and created it into a product that we take for granted every day. Very few things are actually grown that you pluck from the tree or the bush and then you can use in their status other than food and some fibers. Everything else was mined. Natural resources, chemical process in a plant that was put together. So we need these materials. How do you harvest these materials? How do you do it in the most efficient and safe manner? So there's little harm to the environment or the operators of the equipment, and that you're using the energy to mine those materials in the most efficient manner. The other part of materials is once that raw material is mined, value is added to it, and it creates a product that we use in our everyday life. How do you ensure that that product then gets the maximum life cycle out of its expectancy? That means recycling, for Caterpillar, remanufacturing, reusing, adding value to it a second time so you don't have to go back and get those natural resources again and use all the energy through the production process to bring it back to where it was. And I'll tell you a little story about our remanufacturing technologies that we've actually honed here at the University of Illinois. The other intersection is mobility. We've talked about transportation, materials. The third one is mobility, which could be efficiently getting your products to market. About one of every third on-highway truck or semi-truck you see on the interstate has got Caterpillar power underneath its hood. A lot of people don't recognize that. Or getting the materials from the mine site to the processor. through Caterpillar clean diesel technology in our hauling trucks, quarry, and mining trucks as well. So mobility plays a key role as well. And the fourth intersection is development. And a lot of people aren't comfortable with Caterpillar talking about development, but we clearly think we have a role in determining how we help build the world's infrastructure. At the basic elements of the company Caterpillar, we make progress possible. We provide products and services that help develop infrastructure, whether it's transportation, airports, roads, bridges, sewers, clean water to communities, reliable electricity to communities, the basic building blocks that help people live healthy, safe lives and add value, participate in the economy. And we have a huge role in helping to determine whether or not those infrastructure projects are built the most efficient way possible or if they're just built by whatever is available. 15 years ago, our largest competitor in China was the pick and shovel. The Chinese government wanted a full employment economy, so they put 150,000 people with picks and shovels and rollers out to build a road. And they'd build a pretty good road. They'd dig it up and they'd turn it over and they'd compact it, and 150,000 people working day after day after day would build kilometers of roads, and they didn't have heavy trucks and a lot of automobiles, so it would withstand the traffic that they had. But once the economy started growing and trucks and automobiles and heavier pedestrian and passenger use came in, the roads wouldn't hold up. So they'd put these people back at the beginning of the road and start rebuilding the road again. Well, you introduce technology with pavers and asphalt and concrete and compactors and tractors and motor graders, and they find that they can build several hundred kilometers of roads with 40 or 50 people that last decades. So there's some development there as well. Now, from the Chinese government perspective, what happened to the other 149,950 people that used to be employed building that road? They've got better infrastructure, but they've got to deploy additional resources to ensure that those people retain a quality of life and have a role to play as well. Now, every business has an impact, and we can all contribute. I'll give you a few examples today of how Caterpillar does that, but it's clear that every business and every person actually has an opportunity to contribute to sustainable development. And in its most basic sense, that means ensuring that the processes and the materials we use today don't interfere with the prospects of future generations to use those same materials to have a quality of life that's equal to or better than ours. Opportunities will appear. Sometimes you'll be very surprised on where they come up with. A fluke idea in a college campus, a classroom, or a laboratory may turn into the world's largest internet search site, right? What was Netscape, right? Developed here at U of I back in the days when I was shortly after college. You know, a couple of guys playing around came up with an idea. Nobody gave it much credence, and it turned out to be the boom of the internet generation. Employees, communities, customers, suppliers, everybody can help. So have an open mind, listen to what other people have to say, apply your resources to that to kind of filter out what makes sense for you and what doesn't, and then try to act upon those to make the world a better place. And investors and lenders will be asking, if they're not already, if you just look at the questionnaires that come out from investment banks now, the Dow Jones Sustainability Index, the Carbon Disclosure Process or Project, the SAM Group, the FTSE for Good over in the UK, the investment bankers are speaking with their money now on the stocks that they want to buy on major corporations to see if you have a plan, if there's a carbon price on carbon, or if there's a market price set on carbon, if there's a climate change legislation passed in the UK or in Canada, how's that going to affect your markets? Are you properly protected for it? Are you prepared for it? And can you respond? This is something that is new in just the past 4 or 5 years, because historically, the only emissions anybody's ever cared about were the criteria pollutants under the Clean Air Act, right? That's PM, NOx, and SOx, essentially. Carbon's always been free. Nobody really cared how much carbon dioxide you put up in the atmosphere, whether it was a coal-fired power plant or the tailpipe emissions of an automobile or the diesel exhaust stack of a D10 tractor. Carbon has always been free. Well, that is likely going to change. Probably not overnight, probably not on every continent of the world, but eventually, looking through our crystal ball, we think that's going to change, and so people have to start getting prepared for it. Now, some of the things Caterpillar's done, we've been involved in the EPA, United States Environmental Protection Agency's Climate Leaders Program, for over a decade. And essentially, this is a voluntary program where you you set goals in cooperation with the EPA to reduce your carbon footprint or your greenhouse gas emissions. And Caterpillar's initial goal was a 35% reduction of intensity on our CO2 equivalent, so that's all the greenhouse gases, just simplified into a CO2 equivalent. From 1990 to 1992, we set a target of, from 1990 to 2002, excuse me, we set a target of a 35% reduction. And in 2000, we exceeded that goal. So we went back to climate leaders and said, okay, we've achieved our goal. We're going to set a new, more aggressive goal. So we went for an additional 20% improvement from 2002 to 2010. And again, this is a reduction in greenhouse gas intensity. So that it means that it's normalized for revenue. Now, if you know anything at all about Caterpillar, the company has doubled its size in the past 4 years. So we've had a very strong top-line sales figure from about a little over $20 billion to about $45 billion U.S. dollars in sales. So a intensity reduction on CO2 essentially means as long as your top dollar line is growing very rapidly, you can have a moderate increase in your CO2 emissions every year and still see a significant reduction in your greenhouse gas intensity. Because the math would state, if your company doubles, your emissions can double. So as long as your emissions are going up at a slower rate than your top-line revenue is, you'll see an intensity reduction. So in fact, while the company doubled in size, our greenhouse gas emissions went up somewhat. They just went up slower than the top-line sales growth. So our 20% additional reduction in greenhouse gas intensity was actually met and exceeded last year in 2007. So now the company is set back, and we're working with the EPA to establish, and this is going to be very challenging, we want to now establish a greenhouse gas total reduction, not an intensity reduction. We want to, the company is going to continue to grow. Our forecast is that we're going to hit about $50 billion in sales somewhere around 2010. So while the company continues to grow, we want to see a net reduction in our total greenhouse gas emissions. And that really lies into challenge. Because when we met our initial 35% reduction, it was really kind of simple. That was the low-hanging fruit. We switched a lot of coal-fired boilers in our largest plants around the world to natural gas. And we did that for a couple of reasons. One, natural gas was dirt cheap. Okay? So it made good business economic sense to switch the fuel. We didn't do it necessarily to reduce our greenhouse gases because the plant engineers at those facilities, they were never tasked to measure carbon output, but they were tasked on managing the bottom line on energy consumption. And so you get a lot of energy savings when your natural gas prices are very, very low. Now, 10 years, 15 years later, it turns out to be a huge environmental story because natural gas produces about half or a third, depending on the quality of the natural gas, CO2 equivalent emissions. So we had it really helped us on our climate leaders' journey here. But one of the reasons is, and this is actually kind of funny, one of the reasons that we actually switched from coal was the plant manager came out every day, and when you're burning all this coal in the fire, you can't catch everything in the flue, and there was a light film of dark carbon dust on his windshield every day. He didn't like that, so we built a garage to cover the cars, and then it still got in after that. When we switched to natural gas, all that went away. So we did two things. We saved money, we cleaned up the car, some of the pollutants there in the environment made the environment around the facility much cleaner as well. But these are voluntary approaches that we've been doing for more than a decade prior to any real consideration or thought of climate change legislation, carbon mitigation, some of the things you read about in the papers today. The company has a very strong legacy of innovation. We invest over $5 million a day. These are 2006 numbers. Our annual report for 2007 is going to be available in about a month, and that number is going to go up to about $7 million a day. Each and every working day we spend on research and development with our hundreds of PhD scientists, many of them graduates of the University of Illinois. We've had nearly 3,000 patents in the past 5 or 6 years, patenting technology, innovation, to create an engineering leadership in the markets that we serve. And we're recognized for developing clean diesel technology that we call ACERT, which is pretty phenomenal in its own right. We've taken the emissions from a diesel engine and reduced them by 90% from 1996, 1997 to 2006. A 90% reduction in criteria pollutants, PM, NOx, and SOx, and we'll have a further 90% reduction from 2006 to 2010. These engines now are so clean that depending on where you operate them, if you're in a non-attainment area in the United States, the exhaust air is cleaner than the air that comes in through the intake manifold on the front end of the engine, because the technology combusts that so clean, and with a diesel particulate trap on the back end, you can hold a white handkerchief up over the exhaust pipe and rev the engine as hard as you can, and it'll come out with a clean white handkerchief, no particulate matter at all. The technology involved in this, we leveraged four key strengths that we have at Caterpillar. The first one is flexible fuel systems. We're innovators in flexible fuel systems for compression ignition engines. Flexible air systems, the turbocharger, was invented at Caterpillar. And then that technology was licensed away, and now five or six major companies build turbochargers. But that was actually patented by Caterpillar back in the 1940s and 50s. Cat electronics. If you can control the injection, the air, and the burn inside that cylinder, you get a much cleaner, more efficient use of the fuel. And then lately with the aftertreatment, to get those last few particles of PM coming out of the exhaust train. Patented technology that now we have some of the cleanest diesel engines available on the marketplace. You only lead the competition for about 18 months or 2 years before they come up with something very similar. So you've got cooled EGR, engine gas recirculation. You've got urethra injection, other methods to reduce engine emissions, because this is required by the EPA. So all diesel engine manufacturers have to meet the same criteria, but we were recognized for being the cleanest and the first in doing so. Some of the things that we've done internally at the company, Caterpillar Environmental Technologies, 3 or 4 years ago, we established a group to help expand our engine emissions technology to groups that weren't prime customers of Caterpillar. We recognize that we can build clean engines, but we also recognize that not all of our customers want to upgrade to a brand new engine. So our Environmental Technologies group sells diesel emission retrofits to competitive diesel engine users out there on the world. So you can take a 2005 Cummins engine or Detroit diesel engine or one of the others out there and apply Caterpillar aftertreatment and diesel retrofit programs to it and clean it up to the latest available technology without rebuilding the engine or without replacing the engine. We're taking a much harder look at renewable energy than we have in the past. Again, as the world's largest diesel engine and natural gas engine manufacturer, we're petroleum-based. But we recognize that's a finite resource. Now, it's going to last clearly through our lifetime, but what are future generations going to look at? So we're spending much more time on photovoltaic technology, used to be known as the old solar technology, methane management. You know, as a provider of a lot of services to landfills today, both in compaction equipment, D10 tractors to push this stuff through, as well as standby and primary power and electricity, we've developed technology that will convert that methane waste gas into electricity through an engine that will burn the methane and create electricity to both power the site of the waste management facility as well as sell the excess power onto the grid. And there's a real neat story I'll talk to you about in a few minutes that's really taken headlines for us in that past use. So when you think about it, what we're doing is really expanding our market here, creating business opportunities by pursuing sustainable development. You know, on the landfill and landfill gas engines, our products are already prominent on those sites. The customers have purchased our equipment for a long time. Rather than flaring the natural gas, as used to be the case, somebody came up with a bright idea and they said, gee, is there any way we can capture that gas and use it as opposed to flaring it off in the atmosphere? Now, flaring methane is a lot better than just piping it up in the atmosphere, because methane has 23, 24 times the climate-changing effects as carbon dioxide does. So if you flare that and burn it, you reduce that significantly. But again, you're wasting energy. And in the past, you'd see these eternal flames at all the landfills, where they just burn that up in the atmosphere trying to get rid of the gas for primarily safety reasons, because you want to vent it so you don't have you don't have combustion underground. So now we've got the ability to capture that previously wasted gas, convert it to electricity, and it's another cash crop for the mine site if it's coal seam methane, or for the landfill if it's landfill gas methane. So you take a market where you already sell tractors and compactors to, and then you provide a diesel engine or natural gas engine component to that, and they not only make money for taking the refuse in, but they make money for creating electricity and selling it back onto the market. Remanufacturing, which is a key growth opportunity for Caterpillar. Here we took the Caterpillar technology. If you go back to the 50s and the 60s, people used to say, buy a Caterpillar once, have it for life. We manufactured two or three lives into our products. We were able to charge a premium in the marketplace because we knew if you bought a wheel loader in 1955, in 1975, with proper maintenance, it'd still be running. We had the ability to go back and rebuild the engine, repower the engine, redo the hydraulics. Before hydraulics, we could redo the cables for you and provide a second and third life for that product. Well, at the request of a lot of our on-highway truck people, these are the semi-truck drivers out there that get, you know, several million miles on a truck in its useful life, they said, you know, rather than just getting a rebuilt engine, is there any way that we can, if we sign a long-term contract with you, when this engine is done with its useful life, that we can trade it in for a like new one and still have a Caterpillar warranty and the service and availability that we're used to? And so we started a project called Caterpillar Remanufacturing, where we took back in trade used end-of-life diesel engines, took them into a factory, totally disassembled them, tested them, replaced parts with new where needed, rebuilt through welding or cylinder liners or piston packs the areas that needed to be rebuilt, sealed everything up, tested it in the factory, sent it back out with a new serial number, a warranty like new, at 40 or 50% of the cost. And the market accepted that so much that we had to seed the market with new engines to keep the cores or the older engines coming in. It was so successful on the engines that we went to other key components: hydraulic cylinders, hydraulic valves, motors, electronics, undercarriage parts and components, transmissions, final drives. So now Caterpillar's remanufacturing services, one of the largest recyclers in the world in terms of tons of material brought back in, is a very successful, very profitable business for Caterpillar. And if you think about it, I don't know why people didn't actually think about this back in the 60s and 70s, but if you take the original iron that was mined at the mine site to create anything, let's say an engine block, so you mine that ore, you take it to a processor, and you work it into steel components that then are melted down, poured into a mold at a foundry, and create an engine block. And then that engine block goes to the assembly line where it's machined and precision tooled to accept cylinder liners and electronics and fuel systems to create an actual engine. All of that original energy from the natural resources being mined through the process to make a complete engine block and engine assembly, all that original energy is retained. And in the remanufacturing process, they simply disassemble it, replace with new, build up with new engineering drawings to like new status, and put it back out on the market for another lifetime. We save money, the customer saves money, and we save a ton of natural resources in the process. In fact, the energy used to create a remanufactured engine is about 80% less than the energy originally used to manufacture that. So why wouldn't you do that when you have all of those natural resources essentially free, and you provide a competitive value product for your customer and a competitive margin for your corporation? So we've taken that remanufactured technology and expanded our market there as well. Not just to Caterpillar products, but we've acquired a couple of automotive diesel remanufacturing companies in the United Kingdom and in Europe, because Caterpillar doesn't manufacture a diesel engine for automobiles, but we recognize there was a huge market opportunity in Europe, where they do have a lot of diesel automobiles, to provide manufacturing services to non-competitive other OEMs. In fact, we're now doing remanufacturing services for Honeywell on turbochargers, for GM, Ford, and Chrysler and Mercedes on diesel engines in the UK and in Europe, and through an acquisition we made a couple of years ago, Progress Rail Services, which is the largest rail services remanufacturer in the world. And if you think about the rail service in the United States, two things drive rail in the U.S. It's coal and automobiles. And our rail system is pretty much at capacity in the U.S. right now. It's eased up a little bit because car sales are down, but we haven't laid new track in this country for the better part of a couple of decades. A couple of sections have been rebuilt, but we haven't laid new track because primarily fuel has been so inexpensive that it's cheaper to truck than to buy a whole bunch of right-of-ways and lay new railroad lines. So Progress Rail is out there rebuilding rail cars, repowering rail cars with Caterpillar diesel engines, and rebuilding rail sections through a remanufacturing process. All in all, there's over 2 billion pounds of material each year that we bring in through our facilities, refurbish, remanufacture, and send back out with like new warranties and new serial numbers to provide value for another generation of folks to use. That's on the Caterpillar side and the Progress Rail side. Now, if you look at our engine business, we've got a company out in San Diego, California called Solar Turbines. Now, that's a trade name. It's not solar like the sun. These are natural gas turbines that are very, very prominent in oil and gas fields. Again, standby power and primary power for power generation, distributed generation. We do the same thing with our solar turbines that last 20 or 30 years. With regular maintenance, we know when that thing is about the end of its useful life. We'll bring another one in, switch over to the new turbine or the rebuilt turbine, take that one back to the factory, remanufacture it, tear it all down, check for failure, check for wear, check for engineering tolerances, build it back up, and supply a remanufactured unit back to that customer to run for another 25 or 30 years, and just keep the cycle going. They save about half over the cost of new, and yet they have continuous power, continuous oil and gas recovery, whatever the process is they're using for it. In the process of those turbines, we're saving about 75% of the original components that went into that. We're essentially replacing the high, heavy wear, near failure items, and if we do it right, if they follow our program, we'll catch it before catastrophic failure and be able to keep that thing going on a continuous cycle. Methane gas conversion. I talked about this a little bit ago in terms of landfill gases, but what really put Caterpillar in the headlights on this was an agreement we made with the Chinese government a couple of years ago to supply 60 large generator sets to a methane coal project in China. These are engines that are made in our Lafayette, Indiana plant. 60 of these things generate about 120 megawatts of electricity. And it's the world's largest coal seam methane plant in China. It was a competitive bid. We got a third of the engines. A couple of other competitors got 60 engines as well. But the idea was China's mining all this coal to create electricity. They're building the equivalent of a power plant about every 10 days. In fact, every year, China's electricity production, new electricity production, equals the electricity output of the United Kingdom. So every year, they're adding the equivalent of the UK electricity generation. So they've got all this coal. One of the natural occurring substances in a coal seam is methane. Methane's dangerous when you're in a coal mine because it explodes. So they pipe this up, and they said, we want to capture that methane and create electricity. So we sold 60 of these gen sets. We put a press release out there. This was in the summer of 2006, fall of 2006. The phones at Caterpillar right down the road here in Peoria started ringing off the hook because now people are concerned about CO2. They're concerned about greenhouse gases. They said, what do you mean? You have an engine that will convert methane to electricity? They've got a couple of mechanisms in the world right now. One is called the Clean Development Mechanism, which is where developed countries pay producers of electricity and producers of large power projects to reduce greenhouse gases in developing countries. So now there's money available for somebody to go into China and put a methane burner, methane digester, into a power plant to create electricity. In fact, in several of these areas, the electricity that you produce is worth, let's just use a number, say it's $1 million. So you can produce electricity that's worth $1 million, you can get $1.2 million in credits for reducing greenhouse gases through the Clean Development Mechanism. So if there wasn't a business reason for you to burn that methane and create electricity, there certainly is a business reason now that there's cash available to reduce the carbon footprint of that project through the clean development mechanism. That project was so successful that they came back to Caterpillar and said, okay, we want 30 additional engines. Now, if you read our annual report, you know these engines are sold out for a couple of years. The demand is so high that if you place an order for one of these engines today, it will likely be the fall of 2009 before you get it. So China came back and said, okay, we've got 60. They're going to be delivered by the end of the year. We want 30 more of them. And we said, you know, it's going to be a while before we can get to you, but we'll put you on the list. And they came back and they said, okay, I'll tell you what, we'll pay a premium. We want these delivered by the end of 2008. And then you have a business decision to make, right? Who gets the engines? Is it who signed the order or who pays the most for it? And those are things that people above my pay grade have to work out. So the idea here is that nobody has all the answers. There's no real silver bullet in sustainable development. A good friend of mine at Duke Energy likes to think of this in terms of silver buckshot. There's a lot of good ideas out there, but it's going to take a whole mixture of them to make a real difference in the world. So you want to work with your business colleagues. You want to work with the citizens, the knowledgeable population. You know, the Internet's really made a lot of people's opinions relevant now, because before they'd sit home, read an article in the paper and say, gee, that doesn't make sense. Now they can blog about it. They can send you an email and say, you know, Disharoon, you're really off base, or you hit the nut on that one. A lot of the informed citizenry out there, academia, much more partnerships between business and universities across the globe, including in a lot of the developed areas of the world that you wouldn't necessarily think you'd go to for some of the smartest technology. But they got some very bright people that simply haven't had access to espouse their views and share their knowledge with people outside. And you can't forget about non-governmental organizations. The same people that used to pour sand and salt in the fuel tanks of Caterpillar products working in the rainforest or working in the gold mines or the diamond mines of Africa now sit across the table for us and say, you know, there really isn't a lot to be gained from shutting down your equipment. There is a lot to be gained from working with you on more sustainable techniques to operate your equipment to provide the world's natural resources to those people who need it. So, in fact, we sit down across the table from the people that used to sue us in court, and we used to have to, unfortunately, arrest for trespassing and damaging our equipment. Just a snapshot of some of the people that we work with at Caterpillar. You'll see the Illinois symbol up there. A lot of the banks, our colleagues in the Fortune 100, a lot of universities across the United States, some of the non-governmental organizations. You can't pick up a periodical these days without reading about climate change, and I'd be doing you a disservice if I didn't at least mention it in my talk on sustainable development today. Now, I'm dating myself here because this picture was taken about a year ago when gas was $2.33 a gallon. But the interesting thing was, if you wanted the premium, it was going to cost you an arm and a leg. I mean, people got creative with the sign here. But in fact, we just coming in today, I saw gas between $2.99 and $3.08 on the way into Champaign. It used to be the world was going to end if gas hit a buck and a half a gallon. And then it was going to end if it hit $2. And then people said, boy, if it ever goes to $3, that's just the economy's going to stop. Well, I remember last summer paying $3.65. But I still paid it, right? I mean, I had a vehicle to drive and had to get to work. Some economists say the behavior in the United States and our consumption, this insatiable need for gasoline and energy, won't actually be affected until gasoline hits $6 a gallon, which is about, I guess, what it cost back in the 70s if you take the time value of money and inflation. Now, I don't want to pay $6 a gallon for gas, but I'll tell you, I did. I lived in Europe for 7 years. Fuel in Europe when I was there cost as much per liter as it cost per gallon in Peoria, Illinois. Towards the end of my stay there, as the dollar started dropping in value, I was paying $120 a week to fill my Camry up with fuel. So I moved back to Peoria, and it was $2.25, $2.50 a gallon, and Dad said, boy, you're going to get shocked at the pump. And I'm like, are you kidding? This is a vacation. You know, it's still $60 or $70 to fill my vehicle, but I was paying twice of that for a sustained time. Now, it doesn't cost Europe any more to refine gasoline than it does here in the United States, but they have a much different tax structure. And that tax structure drives a behavior change. If you have a car in Europe that's over 1.9 liters engine size, which is the equivalent of about a four-cylinder Volkswagen Passat, you pay about $500 in Brussels. You pay about $500 a year as a motor tax. If it goes to 2 liters, So you go from 1.9 liters to 2 liters, which essentially goes from a 4-banger to a 6-banger, and nothing more than that. Your motor tax goes to 1,000 euros, from 500 to 1,000. If you go to a 3-liter engine, which is what I had in my Camry, the motor tax is 2,700 euros. So not only are you paying for it at the pump, but you're paying for it in your vehicle. So consequently, people start buying smaller cars, and they start taking public transportation, and they start buying diesel engines, where diesel fuel in Europe costs about 30% less than gasoline. In the United States, it's about a 30% premium. So the prices that you establish on energy can, in fact, drive behavior, but the economists tell us we're not there yet. So energy availability drives the global economy. I said the energy needs are going to increase about 70% over the next couple decades, but we got to get our carbon footprint down about an equivalent amount, 50 to 70%, or the scientists tell us we're going to have irreparable harm to the environment out there. We have tremendous energy supplies right here in the United States, but we don't use them very efficiently. And the real missing link here is readily available technology. We can capture carbon in a lab. We can capture carbon on small-scale demonstration projects. But nobody's shown yet that you can cost-effectively capture and sequester carbon long-term from major CO2 emitters like a large power plant. So therein lies the challenge. How do we commercialize this technology over the next decade or so that we can build carbon capture and sequestration plants so we can have all the energy we want and not have the negative influence out there on the economy? Now, it's a fact. Coal generates about 40% of the world's electricity, about half of the electricity here in the United States. We're the Saudi Arabia of coal, particularly here in Illinois. I mean, it's our largest natural resource. You can find coal reserves around the world. If we only use coal only, forget about all the rest of the fossil fuels, we've got about 155-year supply. That's my life, that's your life, it's the life of our children, our grandchildren. Why should we worry? Well, the idea of sustainable development means future generations, plural, have access to the same quality of life. If we use it all now, they're going to have to come up with something later. Energy from coal right now is a bargain. U.S. electricity rates are lower than almost any other place in the world, primarily because half of it comes from coal. You throw in nuclear, and boy, those rates really come down. Alternative energy production still, on a cost per kilowatt hour, is much higher on renewable and alternative sources than it is on coal and natural gas. It's coming down, but it's still much higher on a cost per kilowatt hour. So we got to find clean, efficient ways to use what we have while we develop alternative technologies to ease the burden on some of these fossil fuels. Climate change is probably the environmental issue of our times. Okay, it's whether you believe the science or not, and I can debate both sides of it, but I won't do so today. Whether you believe it or not, in the minds of the politicians and the regulators and in the minds of the public out there, it's a done deal. Something's happening. We got to do something about it. So as an industrialist, we've got to prepare both our operations and our company to respond to the challenges that we're going to have from either regulation in a carbon-constrained world or legislation dealing with climate change or energy allocation. And we have to help meet our customers' expectations of being more efficient because they're getting pressure too. And we want to participate in the development of the policy discussions and the technology discussions because you want regulation to kind of force technology, but it can't be so far ahead that you put yourself out of business because you can't reach that goal. So you want to participate to make sure that the regulators and the academics and the legislators understand what you need to develop the technology, how that technology becomes commercialized, and that it has a lasting benefit on the environment. Now, for me, most of you will remember Star Trek here. Climate change is not a linear activity. It's a lot like three-dimensional chess. There's a lot of different things operating in order to address the energy and climate challenges that we face. For Caterpillar, we take three things into account. One is energy security, and I'm not talking about whether or not we get oil from the Middle East. Energy security means when I'm at a Caterpillar factory and I flip the switch, I have available electricity when I need it and the quantities that I need it available right now. Energy competitiveness. What's the cost per kilowatt hour of that energy? Because if we drive the cost too high, you're going to cause me to rethink where I locate my factories. It's got to be competitive because it's such a driver of the business. And you have to look at the environmental effects. If you say, to hell with the environmental effects, let's keep the cost low and make sure it's readily available, you're screaming for regulation because nobody's going to deal with that. If you say, we're going to take in mind only the environmental consequences and drive the cost too high or the availability too sporadic, you're going to kill business and the economy because nobody's going to be able to operate profitably, creating value on products that we mine to give us all the things that we use every day. So you got a three-legged stool there that has to be balanced. A couple of summers ago in China, Caterpillar has a dozen or so factories in China. The Chinese central government decided the economy was getting too hot. It was expanding too rapidly. So on July 30th, they said, for the month of August, there'll be no electricity to the industrial sector. Now, we're manufacturing, 60 or 70 wheel loaders a day. Just pick a number there. And the plant manager gets a call that says, you're not going to have any electricity starting Saturday for 30 days. And so he calls up his boss and he says, we're not going to be able to build any wheel loaders for the next 30 days. Why not? Was there an injury? Is somebody hurt? Is there a supply chain problem? No, we don't have any electricity. Why not? The government shut it off. Can they do that? Well, we got a contract here that says we buy so many kilowatts per week, but it doesn't really matter because the government said the economy is growing too fast. They're going to shut it off to cool the economy. Now, how do you plan a business cycle like that? You can't. So that gets into that whole energy security, available when you need it, in quantities that you need it, at a competitive price, and with an environmental footprint that's acceptable to all. So when we talk about energy legislation or energy regulation or climate change regulation, we want to make sure it has a positive environmental impact, but it doesn't kill the economy or kill the businesses at the same time. And so we got to try to find a balance there. One of Caterpillar's approaches was to be a founding member of the United States Climate Action Partnership. And you'll recognize most of those logos up there. It's about half a dozen or nine very influential non-governmental organizations. It's a bunch of companies out of the Fortune 100. It's a couple of companies that have changed their image. We talked about BP. We talked about Shell earlier. Chrysler, Ford, GM. Whoever thought GM would be sitting at a table calling for increased fuel economy or carbon emission reductions? But the world's changed. So this group got together and we decided that historically in Washington, D.C., the environmentalists would line up on one side of the aisle and industry would line up on the other side and they'd try to kill everything we'd propose and we'd try to kill everything they'd propose and we'd end up with this hogwash at the end of the day that nobody was happy with but everybody could live with. And they said, the time has changed to be a little bit more constructive about this. Let's try to get some influential CEOs. These aren't lobbyists. These aren't John Disharoon sustainable development guys. These are the CEOs of the companies and the CEOs of the NGOs sitting down at a table saying, let's see if we can come up with six or a dozen policies we can all agree with. And from that, we'll formulate recommendations to Congress that says, this is what we think in national energy legislation or climate legislation. Recognizing that the federal approach is really the only thing that's going to be effective in a country like the United States. We can't have a patchwork of 50 different states doing their own thing with different timelines, different projections, different regulations. That kills commerce. A company like us, a school like you, can't compete if you can't export your diploma to somebody to go to Indiana to work, or you can't export your diploma to somebody in Missouri to go to work. We don't want all these regional hodgepodge approaches for climate and energy legislation. It's got to be in Washington. It's got to be economy-wide, so you have to hit as much of the greenhouse gas emissions as possible, and it's got to be mandatory. Everybody's got to play, because if you don't, you create winners and losers right away. Caterpillar says it's the right thing to do. We're going to play. Tractor Company B says, we're not going to do that. So we'll continue to do business as usual, and we'll sell at an undercut price of Caterpillar and create our own market and incentive for people to buy our products. So those are kind of the underlying principles of the United States Climate Action Partnership. It's been together for over a year. These are not easy conversations. We have to talk about issues like coal. We have to talk about carbon capture and sequestration. We have to talk about nuclear. I mean, nothing is off the table. If we're going to respond to the energy crisis that many people think exists in the world today, everything's got to be on the table. The cleanest way to generate electricity today is still nuclear. So some of the NGOs had to kind of rethink their position about no nuclear at any cost. A lot of these people petitioned not to have new coal-fired plants built in the United States because of the CO2. And now they got to rethink their position and say, well, maybe it's okay if we build new coal as long as it's carbon capture and sequestration ready when the technology is commercially available. That's a big difference between just saying no new coal, because we recognize the demand curve for energy is going to continue to increase. Many people kind of put the climate challenge in perspective to the moonshot back in the 1960s. It's such a big deal. It means so much to people around the world that the only real way to get at this issue is to have a national program partially funded by the federal government and entrepreneurs at universities and businesses across the country that say, we're going to get carbon capture and sequestration, we're going to get alternative energy, we're going to get alternative fuels right, and we're going to spend a couple of tens of billions of dollars in the next decade to do it, put dedicated resources into it, make it a national program, and put somebody on the equivalent of the moon, which is figuring out a clean way to burn coal, figuring out a clean way to get competitive costs of kilowatt hours through alternative mechanisms, figure out a way, and let's just look at solar technology here. Photovoltaic, 15 years ago, to provide enough energy from solar energy to power the United States, you needed a solar grid the size of the United States. And a solar grid, you know, it's made up of a lot of silicone. There's a lot of fossil fuel involved in that, too. Today, to create enough electricity to power the United States, you need a solar grid that's about 100 square miles. So you drive from here to Peoria, that's one leg, and make a block, figure out the other three sides of that square. Still a huge photovoltaic grid, but it's come down from the continental size of the United States to 100 square miles. What does the next 10 years have in store for us? We need the R&D, we need the entrepreneurship, we need the innovative demonstration technology to make sure that happens. We can meet the climate challenge, we can meet the energy challenge, but it means everybody working together to try to get that done, and we think companies like Caterpillar have a significant role to play in that. So, hope I didn't run too long, but I'd be happy to take any questions that you've got.
Questions for John?
Yes?
You mentioned that you're ahead of your achieving targets for the EPA program.
Yes.
And you dropped it from 35, roughly 40%. Can you speak to what the rest of the 60% is and where you're targeting the next reductions to occur?
Yeah, right now our greenhouse gas carbon CO2 equivalent is about 2.19 million metric tons a year. So we're doing a couple of things. We're in the process of reconfiguring all of our factories with what we're calling the Caterpillar production system, which is a great big borrow from the Toyota production system, figuring out the most efficient way to get material throughput in the plant, which is going to eliminate an awful lot of steps. So efficiency in operations. We had some pretty silly things like forced air heating, venting, air conditioning in our open factories. Every time you open up the door in the wintertime, all the hot air goes out. And so now we're going to radiant heat, natural gas fired at the roof that just heats the area and the infrastructure of the plant. 60-70% energy savings in the facilities that we've put those in. Switching out old fluorescent lighting with compact fluorescent lighting in our offices. Energy sensors, lights going on and off when people aren't using, you know, a lot of common sense things. Used to be every time you walked into a Caterpillar factory, whether it was Saturday afternoon firing up the boiler for the first shift on Sunday, or Thursday afternoon between second and third shift, in the background you'd always hear air compressors going and going and going. That's liquid gold. We now turn on the air compressors when we need them, and we shut them off when we don't. But the old technology was, if you left them running all the time and put an oil can on them, they'd go for 15 or 20 years. The new technology is, you flip them on when you need them, they use much less energy, and they don't require the maintenance they used to, so you only turn them on when you need them. Those are some of the examples. We have a policy of every new greenfield building, whether it's an office or a factory, we will build to LEED certification status. LEED is a green building status, essentially, which means energy efficiency, recycled material, ability to recoup your costs over 5 to 7 years. So the dozen or so plants that are on the drawing board for China right now will all be built to U.S. LEED green standards.
So let's take a U.S. facility. If we implement all these, lighting, efficiency improvements, and HVAC, and so on,
Yeah, that's tough because our factories do different things. But what we're looking for is, and these are very bold goals, and they haven't been approved by the board yet. That meets next week, I think. But it's we're looking for a 5% reduction in total greenhouse gas emissions by 2010 and a 20% reduction by 2020. And keep in mind, we expect the company to grow significantly. So
this is still from the 1990s?
No, this is from 2008, new base. Yeah. So it's a challenge. I got a lot of people that aren't happy with me right now, but we're trying to make a difference. Yes? We have some R&D people that work on photovoltaic technology. Primarily what we're looking for is a diesel photovoltaic combination. So in areas of the world that need energy that have clean fuel supplies, because you can't burn these new diesel engines unless you have a good ultra low sulfur fuel supply. But they've got a lot of sun. So the photovoltaic will operate and provide electricity or pumping stations, and when the sun's not out, it'll switch on to a clean diesel generator and provide continuous power. We're looking at partnering with people like BP and others who have the solar technology that we can then couple with ours to provide a solution to people. We've got some photovoltaic cells creating electricity at our tech center and a couple of facilities right now in California. Huge opportunity in the southern cone where the sun shines all the time. But it's right now the cost return of it. It's still a research project because we can use combined heat and power from our diesel and solar turbine test beds and provide cheaper electricity than we can get from solar.
You may have a lot of business from China too. I heard in some of those cities, when they build new cities, they have pretty much 80% energy powered by solar.
Yeah, and the technology's advanced such that they couldn't do that a decade ago. But what's interesting about China is they're not going to go through the technological baby steps that we took from the 40s, 50s, 60s, 80s, and 90s. They will get today's technology tomorrow. And it's going to be provided primarily by Western technology companies, but they will be, in certain areas of China, they will be more advanced than Germany, which right now has more photovoltaic than anybody else in the world, more than California in the next 2 or 3 years. And they didn't have any 10 years ago. Huge opportunity. Yes?
In the whole gamut of sustainability, looking at A to Z and the unknown letters in between there, what tools does Caterpillar use to discover and uncover different sustainability ideas? What drives you down a certain road?
That's a great question. The value chain from A to Z and everything in between on the sustainable development journey, what drives Caterpillar to pick one and try to pursue it? We spend about 20% of our total R&D budget is what we call our sustainability portfolio. And we're a pretty conservative company, so we take our existing business and we look just adjacent to it. So we have landfill operators and we look at methane gas. We have mechanical drive mining trucks, we look to electric drive. We have diesel engines, we look to natural gas. We have natural gas, we look to LNG and hydrogen. So we get pretty close to our core there, but each R&D project that is funded at Caterpillar, and we go through a funding process not unlike what you have at the university level, each project has to go through a sustainability feature or a checklist. So it's a filter, and the questions, and we helped write them, I won't remember them all, but does this product, say it's a new D9 tractor, does this product consume less fuel per brake horsepower hour than the previous model? Is this product designed for remanufacture, which is a requirement on the corporation now? Can you pull all those major components at the end of their useful life, rebuild them, remanufacture, and sell them like new? Does this product lighten the footprint, the carbon footprint of the manufacturing environment to build it, fewer pieces? Or does it lighten the footprint of the operator who's using it at the end? Compaction in the ground. There's a dozen or so questions that have to go through. Failing the sustainability filter won't kill your project, but it immediately elevates it up to the executive office, and they look at that and say, well, why aren't you? So we're incorporating sustainable development at the earliest hour of our R&D and new product introduction to get people thinking about these things. And in fact, it's been eye-opening because we give engineers an opportunity to say, can you spend a dollar now more on a gear? You used to build a gear to last 15,000 hours. Can you spend a dollar more now and have an additional coating or another thousandth of an inch of hardness on that in a heat treat furnace to save $70 down the road and get 30,000 hours as opposed to 15,000 hours. Before they engineered and designed for 15,000, that was it. Now they've got the flexibility to say, now what can I do to this differently to make sure that when we go to remanufacture it, all we have to do is buff it and polish it as opposed to building it back up with weldments. So it's created some innovation in the R&D and new product introduction fields as well. But there isn't really a magic letter or magic number to pursue. One of the goofiest ideas ever developed at Caterpillar was remanufacturing. I joined the company 20 years ago, and half the executive office at that time thought it was a fallacy. They said, you're competing with new parts, you're competing with our dealers, nobody wants to buy used stuff, and now it's turned out to be one of the fastest growing, most profitable divisions in the company. So there are plenty of opportunities, and we're not even sure where they all lie at this point. Yes?
One of your slides, you had the lines of zero landfill. Is this, and we hear this zero emission, zero landfill, zero something. Is it attainable? Is it, or is it just a buzzword? Or do you think that we essentially reached to a point where we nearly recycle everything with no byproduct?
Great question. Zero landfill. For us, it means zero landfill, zero trucks going to the landfill. We used to do, again, we did some silly stuff just like everybody else. Our products are shipped on train cars and semi-trucks and boats all over the world. And the equipment is so large that it requires a lot of blocking, a lot of virgin wood cut to hold the blade in place and the ripper in place and the engine in place, strapped down with chains and steel bands. When he'd get to the dealer, he'd pull it off and throw it off to the side, maybe reuse it, maybe build a picnic table, usually have a bonfire with all that wood. Well, we set up a process about a decade ago to ship that wood back to the factory so we could use it again. We used to burn pallets in our boilers, throw it right in with the coal and burn it and create electricity and a lot of pollution. Now we have pallet recyclers all around the world that come and pick those things up, pull the nails, straighten them out, bend them back down, heat treat them so they meet all the import standards for bugs and algae and everything else across the world. In our five largest facilities in the world right now, the only thing that goes to the landfill is cafeteria waste. And we're working with waste management to ensure that that cafeteria waste goes to a landfill that actually can separate that, use it for compost, or burn it through methane combustion. So we're working with waste management, one of our big corporate clients. So we hopefully, if we meet our 2010 goals, we'll be able to say at our largest facilities we are in fact zero landfill, which means all of the hazardous waste goes to a hazardous waste recycling. We get it back, or we're making money or paying somebody to pick that up. And the cafeteria waste, if it's composted properly, doesn't go, which means eliminating things like styrofoam from your cafeteria, which is a big deal when you work in a factory. Everybody likes to get their fries and styrofoam and go sit at their desk and listen to a radio. We're trying to use recycled straws, recycled paper, recycled napkins, get rid of styrofoam because it takes like a billion years to to decompose. So we hope that it's going to be zero landfill. Zero emissions is something different. Physically, that's not possible. Even a hydrogen engine has got water emissions. So is it zero criterion pollutant, zero pollution emissions? We don't know. We just know there's a bold goal to have as lowest emissions as possible, and we challenge the organization to get as close to zero as we can. But zero emissions is something I really struggle with. I'm not a real fan of being carbon neutral. By buying carbon credits and offsetting your breath or your car or your airplane flight, to me, doesn't make any difference. There's no guarantee somebody's planted a tree or that tree's going to compensate you. So zero emissions, CO2 is a byproduct of breathing. I don't know that we can ever be carbon neutral, but we can do a lot to reduce our footprint. Yes?
How about areas of water use and water reuse?
We have... Water is something that when you have a heavy manufacturing operation like us, it's a necessity, particularly when you have heat treat because you need it to cool. We have one facility out of over 200 around the world that drives about 80% of our water usage, and that's our foundry in Mapleton, Illinois, situated right along the Illinois River. The great news about that is the water that we put back in the river is much cleaner than the water we take from the river because we have very high technologically advanced cooling systems. We got to clean the water before we can use it or it gums up all of our pipes. So the water that we use, we put back cleaner than what we take out. But we still recognize that there are things we can do in our factories to have a better capture of water, storage, reclamation, and reuse. So we are a heavy consumer of water in a couple of factories, but our 2010 goals are to reduce or hold flat our water use with the increased size of the company. So while we grow the company, we're going to keep our water use flat, and then we're going to figure out ways to reduce it. But our remanufacturing operations in Mississippi take condensation, condensed water, off of the chillers and the air conditioners and capture that and use it to cool the machining tools, for example. Introduce it with some antifreeze and some cooling liquids, and all of that water used to come out of our sediment pond, and now we get 80% of it off the chillers that used to just be piped into the drain. So we're figuring out ways to do it, but we recognize we're not as big of a user as water as like an ethanol plant. It's heavy where we have heat treat and foundry operations, but we're trying to keep that flat as we grow the company and then figure out ways to get it back down. And it might mean, if we ever get into a hydrogen economy, creating water from power generation, but we're not there yet. Yes?
I'm just wondering, are there any research and development activities in your company to develop new materials and processes to capture CO2 directly from, say, emission sources such as engine emission, or except for those energy saving measures or energy efficiency measures? Is there any R&D?
There sure is. The question is there any R&D underway at Caterpillar to capture the CO2 emissions from an engine source, for example? Yeah, there are, and we have people working on it every day. A couple of them, you know, like a membrane that you can put over the exhaust. Our exhaust runs too hot, and it melts the membrane, and that doesn't work. There's a theory of carbonics where you can inject a limestone or a type of sand that once the CO2 is liquefied, it creates a rock and stores the CO2 forever. We're looking at that. Actually, that's a technology we'd like to see commercialized, because if you think about it, train loads and train loads of coal going into stationary power plants, right? If they capture that CO2, particularly in Illinois, and they liquefy it and inject it into sand, which is very prevalent here, all those trains leaving, instead of leaving empty, can leave with carbonics, the rocks that they've just created from the CO2 sequestration. Maybe that's a pipe dream. It makes sense to us because we build the loaders and the trucks that help unload that and move it back around. But if you think about it, what a great way to capture carbon and sequester it forever. You don't have to worry about if it leaked out, because you can see it. It's in a rock. And the studies that I've seen where they do this on small scale, you can actually pick up the rock and feel it and it's there, and you don't have the liquid CO2 and you don't have the sand dust anymore. So hopefully something like that. Whether or not that would work for a mobile source, I don't know. You're driving a semi-truck down the highway and you eject sand and you're putting pebbles out on windshields, probably not. But there, who knows what can happen. Maybe you could create that and create some sort of a filter, like a diesel particulate trap that captures the CO2, hits it with an enzyme or a catalyst, and then you have something that you can dump that's environmentally friendly but doesn't have the CO2 released into the atmosphere. But we got a whole team of people working on carbon capture and sequestration, because in my mind, if you capture the carbon, you solve the energy crisis, right? You can burn coal for as long as you want. It doesn't matter if it's Powder Basin or Mattoon, Illinois. If you capture the carbon, you no longer have the environmental disadvantage that everybody thinks coal has right now.
So you mentioned the CO2 storage with a sensor, something like that.
Yeah.
So which kind of reaction, the CO2 plus, something like calcium carbonate or...
Exactly. Dioxide? Carbonation is what it is. It's
if you want to use the carbonate, say limestone, calcium carbonate, we need to get rid of the CO2 first, right? We need to decompose, thermodecompose the limestone first, then you get the calcium oxide. Before we can use calcium to capture CO2.
Yeah, and the whole theory of carbonics is that when you
need energy to compose the low material.
Yeah, you need power to create that. There's no doubt about it. But what you're doing, if you do it theoretically, is you're capturing the CO2 both from the combustion and in the power conversion process to inject it into whatever your carbonic base is. Yeah. Again, I haven't figured it out. I saw the rock that they said was made that way, and it sounds promising.
Sure.